We do need to transition to our next panel now, and we're talking now about the topic of housing and health. So I do want to introduce our moderator, Jack Spengler. Dr. Spengler is the Akira Yamaguchi Professor of Environmental Health and Human Habitation and Director of the Center for Health and Global Environment at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. He's conducted extensive research over the years on indoor air pollution, housing design, green buildings, and effects on health. He served on many National Academy committees, been advisor to the World Health Organization on indoor air issues, has many, many awards over his career, and so on and so forth. And here he is.
Yeah. And I'm proud of my doctoral student, too. Yeah.
And I should say, a mentor to many people here in the audience over the years.
Thanks, John. I'm going to suggest, how often do we sit this long? We were enraptured by this presentation, so... While I'll give the introduction talk, stand up. Just stand up and stretch and refresh, and I'll just speak over you, and you can get a little back stretch again. Right? So happy to be here. And I have to compliment the planners. I mean, how could they have foreseen the shift in our political landscape a year ago when they planned this meeting? And I think, Ron Sims, it's clear. You said it. It's a call for action. But... look, we're in the game already, but I think it really says we got to redouble and double our efforts again. You look forward, next 4 years could be we're in a social war, and it's a social war for health being human rights, for the dignity of all people, and I think we ought to think about it this way. This is going to be a rocky couple of years, so I think all the more reason why our school at Harvard, school here at BU, at Tufts, this is our city, this is our community, and we've collaborated and will continue to collaborate for years to come. So we're going to pivot. We talked about communities. Ron talked about communities. We're going to talk about housing, and we have a great lineup. So I'm going to introduce the speakers, but then hold your questions. They're each going to talk, and then we'll get them all up here and then ask your questions at that point. And I think you will hear, and I think it brings true Churchill's saying, is that first we shape our buildings and then our buildings shape us. And this is so true about our housing stock, that we spend 17 hours a day in those residences. So you have a great little bio of the speakers in this program. So I'm just going to give you the Twitter version of this. Oh, by the way, did you hear the news on BuzzFeed that there was a big merger announced today? You hear about this? Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube have merged. New companies, you twit face? Did you? So we just joined one? Old Jay Leno joke. All right. Anyway. David Jacobs, come on up. David is with the Center for Healthy Housing, where he's a senior researcher in that center, doing really interesting work. You'll share some of those studies. Worked, advised HUD, PAHO. But I think his role is really pivotal. His role as the former director in HUD of the Housing Office of Lead Hazards Control and Healthy Housing. It was on his watch that healthy housing was added to the mandate of that office. And I think the groundwork that he laid in those funding of research and demonstrations have real policy change, because it led to the announcement just the other day of smoke-free public housing. This is a hard thing to do, but it is based on evidence. And I think, David, we support you for that. Come on up, stand next to me. I will then jump back up and introduce the next speakers after you talk, okay?
So, I don't know which is worse, actually. This is the part of the day where food coma starts to set in, or I try to follow Ron Sims. Where'd he go? He already left. But I want to say how he has this special gift of making the right thing seem obvious. And we need a lot more of that, don't we? So let me jump into this, because I know we're a little behind. So this is not really a new idea that housing and health are related. Florence Nightingale had this observation a long time ago that the connection between health and the dwelling of the population is one of the most important that exists. This is a picture of miasma, right? Bad smells that stalk the neighborhoods of the poor, over lung. This is sort of before we had the germ theory. And if you go to the Tenement Museum in New York City, you will see what's called a tubercular window. So these are the tenements. They had three units on each floor, basically. One near the street, one in the middle, and then one in the back alley. And the only way they could ventilate the interior unit was to put in these interior windows. So this is sort of the early phase of thinking about ventilation, and I'll return to this later on in my talk. But this idea that housing was related to communicable disease was what launched the sanitation movement. And in some ways, we need to get back to that because this connection is absolutely essential. So this is a picture of the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland back in the 60s, the 50s and the 60s, where it caught on fire not once, not twice, but several times. So the public looked at this and said, we breathe that air and we all drink that water. We want something done about this. So this is part of our shared commons, and therefore this is why we have the Clean Air and the Clean Water Act, isn't it? So the question is for housing, is it part of our shared commons? And is it part of our infrastructure? And we're about to enter a debate about what is the infrastructure, what is in it, and what is not. So this is one definition. it's everywhere, the air we breathe, words we speak, traditions, ancient and modern, local and global. But then the kicker is the last sentence. It's everything that is not privately owned. Well, most houses in this country are what? Privately owned, right? So that implies that they are not part of our shared commons. And that's why housing regulation and laws and health housing is fragmented and diffuse. So this has created a problem. If you look at it from a building owner's perspective, making a health investment in housing makes no financial sense. It's unlike any other housing improvement. So if you put a new roof or a new furnace in your home, when the time comes for you to sell that home, the appraiser will come in and he'll say, your home is worth more because you improved it. When you make a health investment, the market doesn't know quite how to monetize that. And so Dr. Frumkin mentioned earlier this morning that the markets don't work. And this is one reason why. So right now, most of these health investments are unlike any other home improvement. And so we need to think about not just regulation, not just enforcement, but also some market vehicles that enable the housing market to properly price health investments. Otherwise, we're going to be stuck with just articulating what the cost is of unhealthy housing, whether it's lead poisoning or asthma or mold-induced illness and the like. So we have to get past that. We have to think more clearly about how you stimulate investments so that they produce the positive health outcomes that we want. So these are the seven healthy homes principles. You can probably think of some others. But we basically think the idea is if you do these seven things, you will have multiple health benefits. So for example, if you just look at moisture, what sorts of things does that correct? Well, it eliminates lead paint deterioration. Moisture is the leading cause of premature paint failure. Injuries from structural rot and falls. Asthma and respiratory disease from mold. Pest intrusion and allergy and asthma. Both intrusion as well as exposures. And then radon infiltration. So all of these things can be addressed by looking at a housing as a system and doing things that improve just the one thing, moisture. I wanted to bring people's attention to this. This is something we released now 2 years ago, National Healthy Housing Standard. This is basic with the American Public Health Association. This is basically an update of the old 1985 Basic Housing Manual. But it now has new things that reflect the current science, particularly with chronic diseases. So I'd encourage people to take a look at this and begin the process of getting each of your jurisdictions to think about incorporating this in part or in whole. This is written as a code, a housing code. And right now, every jurisdiction kind of has their own housing code. So it's unlike medical care, right? If you have an appendectomy in Seattle and then here in Boston, you hope it gets done the same way, right? With housing, it's different. Every housing code is jurisdiction specific. And so we need to get to the point where we rely on the science to figure out what goes into our housing codes. This is another report that we worked on with the World Health Organization to estimate the environmental burden of disease related to inadequate housing. And I don't have time to go through exactly how we did this. This is data mostly in Europe. It's not something we've done here in this country, but we need to. And so, for example, in mold, I can't see this myself even. You can estimate the population attributable fraction from relative risks, and you can estimate the disability-adjusted life years. So in Europe, we estimated 55,000 disability-adjusted life years per year, 83 deaths per year. Same thing with dampness, lack of window guards, lack of smoke detectors, crowding and tuberculosis, indoor cold, traffic noise, radon, residential secondhand smoke, lead poisoning, indoor carbon monoxide, formaldehyde, and indoor solid fuel use. So the punchline is, it's huge. The environmental burden of disease with inadequate housing is enormous, but it's not recognized, and we need to find ways to make sure that these quantifications are recognized, especially in the way in which we make housing investments. So what do those investments look like? Remember, I showed you the picture of a tubercular window. This is a recent study we did in Illinois in two jurisdictions, a special program run by the health department to replace single-pane windows. We know that windows have the highest levels of lead paint and lead dust of any other building component. And we will argue that when we do infrastructure, why not replace all of those pre-1940 single-pane windows in our nation's housing stock? That should be part of our shared commons. That should be part of our infrastructure. If you do that, you get five benefits, at least. You get energy benefits. People like windows, so they'll pay more for them. Your value of your home will go up. You get job creation for both people who install those windows, as well as window manufacturers, and lead poisoning prevention benefits as well. Yeah, thank you. So right now, this is how the market works. Most people will look at how much does it cost me to put new windows in my home, how much am I going to get back when I sell that home, but this health benefit in the form of lead poisoning prevention is hidden. It's not recognized, and it needs to be. So this study that we did, you like this acronym, CLEARWIN? Some legislator thought of that. Comprehensive Lead Education and Reduction Through Window Replacement. CLEARWIN. It's a clear win. Not surprisingly, we saw dramatic reductions 1 year later in lead dust on both windowsills and window wells, but also on floors. And that's just to show that most of these things are highly correlated, and the floor dust is typically the ones that are most expensive. So this program worked. We also saw other health improvements in terms of general health, headaches, ear infections, respiratory allergies, and also in asthma. So lead is not the only thing. It's important to think of these other things as well. We also did a cost-benefit analysis. We showed that for the $5 million investment that the bankrupt state of Illinois made, they made $3 million in net benefits. Net benefits. So the program makes financial sense as well as public health sense. And if you want to know how we did this, I can go through it, but it's, well, the bulk of it is lost lifetime earnings due to reduced IQ and lead. Another recent study, another acronym, Health V study, housing and environmental aspects linked to health through ventilation. This was one of those rare randomized trials that we're able to do in housing. Basically, two groups. One group had no mechanical ventilation. Well, both groups had no mechanical ventilation at baseline. And then intervention, some people use the old ASHRAE 89 standard. ASHRAE is the American Society of Heating, Refrigeration, and Air Conditioning Engineers. These are the people who basically articulate how much fresh air should come into our buildings and how it should be distributed. This old standard is still used in a lot of weatherization programs. The newer standard basically requires mechanical ventilation. So the question was, what are the health outcomes associated with these two types of ventilation rate? Well, not surprisingly, the airflow rate was much higher in the newer standard group because it had mechanical ventilation. 79 versus 39 cubic feet per minute. We also saw dramatic reductions in formaldehyde, VOCs, carbon dioxide, and also first floor radon was lower in the newer standard group, but it was higher in the basement, interestingly enough. So this has to do with complicated pressure differentials in homes and how we design these ventilation systems. We also saw dramatic improvements in moisture in the mechanical ventilation group, in both groups, but it was even more pronounced in the newer standard group. So we know that moisture is related to mold and other adverse health outcomes. We also saw other health improvements in children with fewer headaches, eczema, skin allergies, and strength and difficulties score, and adults improvements in mental health outcomes. There were some other health improvements that didn't quite reach statistical significance, probably because the study was small. But general health, respiratory allergies, chronic bronchitis, reduced cockroaches, mice, and rats, fewer leaks, improved temperatures, and improved asthma, all of these things trended in the right direction. So we need more studies like this that are larger to make sure we fully understand what the trends are. So historically, ventilation standards in our buildings and houses, over the last 25 years, they haven't really changed much. In fact, Jack, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, but the historical basis for our fresh air standards is what? Controlling body odor. You'd hope we could do a little better than doing that. So more health outcome studies related to this are particularly important. So there are some reasons to think about lowering ventilation rates. For some of our building materials now, we have improved emission rates for pressed wood, like from formaldehyde, improved source removal, or improved air cleaning technology. And of course, there's an energy penalty if you increase the amount of outdoor fresh air coming in because you have to heat and cool that air. Some reasons to consider increasing ventilation rates, on the other hand, include that we have new chemicals coming into our housing stock. So far in this country, unlike Europe, we wait until a bad building material causes harm, whether it's lead paint or Chinese drywall or whatever, and then we'll react. So, but there are new chemicals, such as spray foam, and we have a better understanding of the toxicology of that, so we might need to bring in additional air to deal with that. Homes now include more activities, in particular home offices. We know that fine particulates are often generated from home office and other materials. We might want an increased level of protection against some of these building-related contaminants. And there's still a problem with properly distributing air in buildings, which turns out to be a very complicated deal. So I did want to highlight one study that I think still remains in many ways the iconic study, I suppose it is. This is Jim Krieger's work out of Seattle, the Breathe Easy homes. These are homes that new construction public housing targeted to asthmatic children. But you'll see here that after they moved into these homes, their symptom-free days over every two-week period increased by about 5 days. That's an enormous improvement. Their trips to the emergency room declined by 41%. That is enormous. And yet it was by making a housing investment that enabled that to work. Asthma triggers and dust, which is basically a euphemism for allergens measured in settled dust, that declined and stayed low for a significant period of time. So this makes economic sense. Improving our housing stock is important. So take a look at this study. There are a number of other studies that I'm not going to have time to go into in great detail, but 5 years ago, if you had asked me, well, what's the evidence, actually, that these green building standards actually improve health? And it was pretty scant. But now it's improved. I mean, in Jill Bricey's work in an elderly apartment complex in Minnesota showed improvements in mental health, falls, and adult general health. Colton study here, and I think it was in Boston, right, showed improvements in particulate matter, NO2, and 47% fewer sick building symptoms. And I think in the interest of time, I won't go through this, but I would highlight this. Most of these studies rely on self-reported health as their sort of outcome measure, and maybe with some air sampling as well. We don't have a good handle on clinical measures. There have been several attempts, for example, to use Medicaid data to quantify the health improvements in housing. And there are some beginning efforts to do that, but it turns out to be complicated. So we need more clinical studies. We need a better understanding of how health insurance costs are translated into addressing housing-related illnesses that could be prevented with better housing designs and improvement. So the problem is that this is the percent of housing with moderate and severe physical problems going back to 85. This hasn't really changed much over the last 20 to 30 years. It's a problem that still remains. And so we need to budge this needle. Our housing stock needs to be improved. Otherwise, we're going to continue to keep paying the cost. We're shifting the cost of inadequate housing to our medical sector, to our school sector, and to other systems. That makes no sense. It doesn't make sense to treat a child with asthma only to release him back into the home environment that made him sick in the first place. So you're starting to see some hospitals, like in Kansas City, that will deploy housing inspectors for certain conditions before they discharge the patient to make sure that the housing remediation is fixed. Here in Boston, I think Dr. Sandel can talk about, you have a referral system where physicians can require a code inspection or request a code inspection for certain patients. So this integration of housing and health is still in front of us. It should be like it was back at the turn of the last century, where the sanitation movement collaborated. You had public health and housing people working together, bringing their own strengths to the table to make sure that our population's health improved. We can't afford to keep those two worlds separated any longer. Otherwise, we'll continue to deal with this, which is silly. So, to conclude, we are now faced, if you think about it, what are the two biggest parts of our economy that are struggling? It's housing. We just got through a horrific mortgage crisis, didn't we? And healthcare, right? We're talking about how to bend the healthcare cost curve. So I think these are flip sides of the same coin. And those of us working in healthy housing bridge that divide. It's kind of crazy to me that the federal government runs basically these tiny little programs looking at this relationship between the two. It ought to be much more organic and meaningful in a way that can promote change in both worlds. I think if we do this right, if we're smart about it, we can get our people back to work. We can improve our infrastructure. And I think the debate about whether housing is actually part of the infrastructure is going to be an important one. Because obviously houses are private, right? But they're also public. You don't need to look any further than the mortgage crisis to realize it's a shared good, isn't it? We buy and sell them from each other. We invite people over. They're expressions of who we are. And yet they're also places of refuge. So making sure that our houses are part of the infrastructure will help stimulate the investment, assuming that there is agreement on improving our infrastructure investments. And then, of course, these energy retrofits in the form of ventilation improvements or envelope sealing will have a lot to do with how we face climate change, or what's the right word now? Climate disruption, I guess, is the term of art. And if we do this right, we can. This is the Cuyahoga River today, not the burning river in years past, but it's a beautiful green space that has been redeveloped because that was what was needed by the citizens to promote their health and the vitality of their community. So let's do this, not the burning river. Thank you.
We'll come back for questions. In fact, when you're on the panel, I want you to share the Michigan experiment going on. So we'll talk about that later. Nice segue. We're changing the order that's listed in the pamphlet to bring up Patricia Fabian. Because Patricia, come on up while I talk. Because it's a nice sequel to what you're talking about. Because she's utilizing the same attributable risk data, the same research base, but putting in an economic model. So how do we know how much to put into repairs of these defects in our housing for the returns that we'll get from it? So it's very much along the lines of what David said. So, Patricia?
Thank you. And full disclosure, I'm an engineer, and I'm so happy to have so much support for engineers because I am one of the only ones in the whole School of Public Health. So it's the first time I've heard engineering so much in any kind of public health meeting. It's really great. So I'm going to switch gears just a little bit and talk a bit about models. We've heard this already, but just to go over, what we try to study is, you know, how does housing impact indoor air quality? How does it impact health? And the question is, it's a very complex system. Why is it complex? So in housing, if single-family housing, how air moves through a house is complex. If you think of multifamily housing, you've got adjacent compartments, shared hallways, shared elevator shafts. That makes it more complex. There's a stack effect, right, of pollutants moving up. So there's complexities just about the structural characteristics of houses. There's complexities about the indoor air quality. There is a myriad of pollutants, right? There's combustion byproducts from things like cooking, burning candles. There's outdoor air, right, so traffic or industry. There's allergens, things like dust mites, mouse allergen, cockroach allergen. VOCs, so volatile organic compounds, SVOCs, and bioaerosols. By this can be pollen from outdoors, bacteria from people, fungi from moldy building materials, or even viruses from people who are breathing. There's interactions between these pollutants. There's interactions between the pollutants and the housing materials, right? Things can change once they enter your house. So complexity number two. Complexity number three are the people who live in the homes. So if you open your windows, that's going to have an impact on how you get exposed to things. If you cook a lot because you do some commercial cooking for a restaurant around the corner, you are burdening your house with pollutants that your house isn't necessarily equipped to handle. If you burn a lot of incense, a lot of candles, turn on your fireplace, don't take care of the ventilation in your, don't replace your filters in your HVAC systems. All this has to do with the people that are living there, right? Nothing to do with the structure, but with what you're doing with how you're living. And then finally, and this is a topic for a whole day, right? The complexities in health and how there's health outcomes that are multifactorial, so impacted by many things. It's hard to quantify rare but costly outcomes. So in the studies that Dave showed, there was a lot of outcomes on general symptoms. Do you feel better? But it's really hard to quantify. If you do something to your house, what is that going to do to your risk of hospitalization? But hospitalization is very expensive. So if you were able to do that, you know, you would be able to quantify and capture better all those health costs. And then things like healthcare, who has access? Do you get prescribed the right medications? Can you buy them? Do you give them to your kid? Are you stressed by other things and then you don't give them? So again, all this is just kind of building up to say this is a really, really, really complex problem. Now this is a complex problem in this micro world of housing, right? This is just the house, indoor air quality, and health. Let's put it in a bigger context. This is a graph from a study done in the UK. And in the UK, they had this single policy of trying to reduce their carbon their housing carbon housing footprint with a single policy goal, so doing energy efficiency measures. And what they found is that these policies that they implemented were underperforming. And the reason was because they failed to look at housing as a complex system. They just saw a house, they said, let's weatherize, let's air seal, let's put insulation. And then they saw that it didn't have the impacts that they wanted. So they took a step back and said, oh, maybe what we should do is think of housing as a system. And they engaged all these different shareholders from government, from housing, you know, homeowners, et cetera. And they came up with this, which puts housing, I put that little graph from before, right, which was very complex already. That's just a little piece of what they found, because then they put it in the context of climate change and energy efficiency, community, neighborhood impacts, land ownership, et cetera. So again, it just builds into this more and more and more and more complex. Now, why do you want to characterize it that way? Well, if you're going to try to figure out what happens when you implement policies of any sort, right, at any of these levels, you need to know what the impact is going to be on health. Why? If you don't have evidence that what you're going to do has an impact on health, then how are you going to generalize it to make policy changes or policy suggestions? And how are you going to monetize it, depending on, no matter who pays, but just how are you going to monetize that what you do to housing is going to impact your health? So after I've built up to say this is a really hard, complex system, how do we look at it? Well, we think of using system science, a system science thinking approach to looking at housing. What is that? It's a family of analytic approaches used to characterize complex systems to evaluate one or more system problems and identify optimal solutions. What does that mean? It's a complex problem. Throw all these analytical tools you can at it so that you can solve it. This isn't unique to public health, right? Public health is full of complex problems. This is what we do. But in this case, what we're trying to do is apply it to housing, indoor air quality, and health. There's two types of modeling that I'm going to talk about. One is on the housing simulation side, so housing simulations and then indoor air quality, and then indoor air quality and health. So how is housing simulation useful? So first, for housing simulations or software or building simulations, what you are doing is taking a real building and converting it into a model that you can use to predict how air moves and how pollutants move in a house. Okay? There's software programs that do that. This is an example. Using a software program to model a house, what you can do is you can say, okay, we can look at relative humidity over a day, right? This is in a house. And then we can look at what happens if we add a humidifier. And this is a study to look and see whether humidification changed the survival of influenza virus. So this was trying to see, you know, could humidifying your house be an intervention to change transmission of influenza virus? So again, the program shows you, okay, this reflects outdoor air. In a day, what you would see of relative humidity in your house, basically reflecting what's outdoors. If you add a humidifier to your bedroom where someone who's infected might be, this is how your humidity changes. And what we did with those simulation models is we then showed that there was a decrease, I don't know if you can see, about 70% decrease in influenza virus survival. Now you're simulating a person who's in a bedroom, who's coughing every so often. This is the amount of viruses that they put out. So there's a lot of components that go into this, but it's a way to, it would be hard for you to measure that in a field study, right? To say, let's change the humidification. Emission rates for viruses are very different. It's hard to capture viruses. It's really hard to measure. Viruses aren't alive, but whether they can still remain infectious or not. But using these models, we can actually make estimates of that. This is another example. This was a housing complex in Boston, Castle Square Apartments, where we modeled townhouses. And what we were trying to do was to see whether weatherization, they went through this very extensive weatherization program. They changed windows, doors, air sealed, added insulation, put in energy efficient appliances, et cetera. So what we're trying to do is, how does that impact indoor air quality? So this is a busy graph, two things to note from it. One is that we were able to see the difference. These are pollutant concentrations, so particulate matter on the y-axis, and then just different interventions here on the bottom. So one is, this is the heating season, this panel over here, and this is the cooling season. The reason the concentrations are much lower is because there were filters in the HVAC system in the winter. So in the winter, there's forced air, it's going through filters, and it was reducing particulate matter concentrations. In the summer, where people were either just opening their windows or had window AC units, you can see that across the board, and this is just, you know, in general, concentrations are a lot higher. So that's one thing that we could measure with these models. The second thing is we can look at human behavior, which again, in a field study, as hard as we try people to fill out their activity diaries and figure out whether they're cooking and turning on their exhaust fans, we don't fully capture that. But in a model, you can control that. So for example, this line up here, this is a home where there was heavy cooking and heavy smoking pre-weatherization. So these were the concentrations. After weatherization, the concentrations go up. Okay, you're tightening the home, you would expect that. However, if people use their fans, so weatherize and use their fans, you can see that the concentrations actually were lower post-weatherization as long as people operated things the way that they were supposed to operate them. So again, these models let you parse that out. Now looking at this graph right here, there's also the dark red, but with the dashes. The only difference between this curve up here, so pre-weatherization, weatherization, weatherization with exhaust fans, it's exactly the same curve except that people were opening their windows. And you can see, now you can capture, again, this human behavior component that is really hard to characterize in field studies, but you can measure it in these models. So this was looking at weatherization and indoor air quality. So this is just a couple examples of what you can do with building simulation. Now let's talk about how to link it to health. And the health problem I'm going to talk about is asthma. So asthma, I thought someone would talk about it before. I had a couple slides in case not. You probably all know. It's a chronic lung disease. It inflames and narrows the airways. It's a disease that is, it's increasing. Asthma rates are increasing in the world in general. And people in urban environments and low income have higher rates. We don't know yet what causes asthma. We're sort of on the path to that. But we do know a lot about what causes asthma exacerbations. And here we've got the same things we've talked about before. We spend 90% of our time indoors. All these pollutants can be found indoors, right? So outdoor pollutants, combustion byproducts, environmental tobacco smoke, biologicals. So this fits the role of we're in housing. Housing is complex. It's a multifactorial disease. That's complex. How can we use system science to study it? This is what a system science model looks like. Basically, what you can do is simulate kids. So again, in the context of asthma, these are asthmatic kids. And you can assign individual characteristics to them based on a population. You can put them in housing and assign characteristics of housing about them, and then march them over time. In our case, we looked at them over 10 years and see what happens to them. They have a lung function, a baseline lung function that varies every day, right, when they wake up. There's a variability in how much PM2.5 they get exposed to, depending on how much cooking was going on in their house, what the pollution was outdoors, et cetera. But you can model that. So you simulate these kids. You can simulate 100 kids. You can simulate a million kids with all these different kinds of characteristics. And then depending on how their lung function changes, you can keep track of their asthma history, you know, asthma medication, et cetera. Depending on how their lung function changes is how their outcomes, their probability of their outcomes changes. So you can then say, we can predict, you know, how many ER visits over 10 years are going to happen in this population, how many hospitalizations. And now you're capturing these rare outcomes that, again, we can't really measure in epi studies and we can't measure in field studies. How is this useful? So you measure a baseline population, right, say 100,000 kids, and you simulate them to the end, and you count how many ER visits, hospitalizations, et cetera. Now what you can do is say, well, what if I tweak something about the building? What if I have a weatherization program and change their buildings, right? You run the same 100,000 kids. The only thing that you have changed is something about their building. And then you can, again, count up how many ER visits, how many hospitalizations, and it's a way for you to evaluate all these different interventions. What if we do an education campaign and have them use their exhaust fans? What if we implement a smoke-free policy in multifamily buildings? All these things, all you have to do is run the same 100,000 kids, right, and then quantify at the end what happens. Where do you get all this information? So the $100 question. From everywhere. And we've heard of all these studies this morning, right, of we've looked at the built environment and health, this and asthma. There is no single study that takes you from housing all through this, all the way to hospitalizations. But there's a lot of information and hundreds of studies that can help you link all of these. So there's field studies, there's epi studies, there's electronic health record data, which is what we're starting to work with a little bit over on this end. You can bring in social stressors, right? How do caregivers who are stressed, how does that impact whether they refill their kids' prescriptions and whether they give their kids asthma medication? This is a very simplified measure, right? There's positive feedback loops here, negative feedback loops, and the whole point is that you're tweaking one thing, but then that changes all those loops, right? Positive or negative, and it'll be a more realistic depiction of what can happen. So instead of this kind of single policy, we're going to solve a problem just attacking one thing, you can actually kind of measure how this goes. Okay, so this is an example of how we use this model. On the x-axis, we're just going to focus on this top graph. So it's asthma symptom days, and then interventions on the x-axis, and then percent change compared to baseline. So again, simulated a baseline population, okay, and then we fix the fans. And what happens is you get a reduction in asthma symptom days. We replaced gas stoves. This was a population where people were using their gas stoves to heat in the winter. So we said, okay, well, what if we take, and they were gas stoves. So what if we take the stoves and then we replace them with electric ones? You're reducing the source. This third intervention was about not turning on the oven for heat, putting in a HEPA filter. So all of these things could impact mold or particulate matter or cockroach allergen. There's integrated pest management. If you weatherize only, right, then symptoms go up. If you weatherize and use an exhaust fan, replace the stove, et cetera. So again, it's a way for you to measure sort of relative what happens with all these interventions. So this is on the health piece. So now let's monetize it. You've now counted up what the difference is in ER visits and hospitalizations, et cetera, right, by each of these scenarios. So now you can look up the cost of an asthma hospitalization, the average time that people stay in the hospital. You know how much ER visits. If people change medications, you know how much corticosteroids cost and whether they're taking different medications. So now this is exactly the same graph, right? So the same interventions on the x-axis and then what the change in cost is. Now you can have a debate who pays, right? Who pays for the housing intervention? Who pays for the savings in medication? Who pays for the difference in hospitalization costs? And again, debate for another day. But just in numbers, right, if you wanted to put a number to it, this is a good way to do it. What do we do with this? Well, now you can say, if it costs you to install a fan between $350 and $550, that implies that you're going to be saving around $173 a year. And so the payback period is 2 to 3 years. And that's a really good tool, right, to be able to say that. With weatherization, and weatherization can go from air sealing, which is pretty cheap, to replacing your windows and everything else, which is actually a lot very expensive. But if it costs you on average $6,500, you're spending $314 more a year. This is weatherization without using exhaust fans or anything else. So an energy savings, this is from an energy saving calculator, is $605 a year. If you were only looking at energy savings, then your payback would be in 11 years. That means that whatever you spent to weatherize, you'll save in energy costs in 11 years. But if you add health, which is costing you more, right, because you didn't do it right, then it'll actually take 20 years to do payback, to get payback. So in conclusion, I just wanted to kind of show you, kind of think, and we should all be thinking in the system science way. Not necessarily that you implement it, but that everything that you do has a consequence for all these other things. And that I hope I showed you that this is a really powerful tool in public health that we can use to measure all the interventions and monetize the way that David said at the end that we needed to do. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Patricia. I want you, when we get back up here, I want you to be thinking of, is it ready for prime time and who is going to use this, all right? So give us some insights on that. Megan Sandel. She's a physician here at St. Elsewhere. No, wait a minute. At Boston Medical Center. They don't get that.
Yeah, I get it.
You get it, I know. I'll just say, Megan has been so generous with her time and experience because she wants to make a difference. And it's not only to us and all the research community, it's to the developers. It's to enterprise community partners that are investing $1 billion a year in new housing for low-income populations. And she is right there helping them to do the right thing. So, Megan.
All right. Thank you so much. I just want to thank John and I don't know if Dean Galea is still here. I want to thank you, Dean Galea. It was just a really amazing day. It's just such a privilege to be on a panel with just amazing people and the speakers. Howie Frumkin is someone that's been a hero to me for many years, and Ron Sims is an icon, so I'm just really excited. I am going to try desperately to talk in less than 15 minutes. We'll see how I do, because I really want to get us to the conversation. I do need to acknowledge a couple people in the room. I'm part of a Children's Health Watch team, which is actually partly based out of the BU School of Public Health, so I want to acknowledge Stephanie Edinger-DeCuba, who is our Research Policy Director. Wave, Stephanie. And she is also a proud doctoral student in the health services area. And then Sharon Coleman, who is also at the Data Coordinator Center, where the data is. Sharon is the person who produces all of the numbers that I'm going to be able to talk about today. I want to talk just for a second. We've been talking about housing and health, and I actually have changed the frame to being talking about home. I actually think there's research actually from enterprise community partners, among others, that when we talk about the frame of housing, we automatically think of four walls and a roof. We think of it as a commodity. We think of it as other. Often you put the word affordable in front of it. Whereas I want to encourage us more and more to try and connect to the word home. The other thing is I've tried to think about is home as a vaccine, and I'll talk a little bit about why I think that. It's something that keeps you healthy now and in the future. And I think that as we think about my healthcare sector and thinking about population health and thinking about health equity, I also want to acknowledge Thea James, who's in the audience, who is the Associate Chief Medical Officer, Vice President of Mission. And really, I thank Thea for also working with me on this mission of how does Boston Medical Center view itself as an anchor institution to create population health and health equity. So the roadmap that I'm going to fly through is quality is something we've heard a lot about, but I'm going to focus on stability and affordability as under-recognizes pieces of a healthy home. I'm going to do a quick nod to location. The panel this morning did such a lovely job, but I feel like I have to at least acknowledge that as the fourth dimension of how housing impacts health. I'm going to talk a little bit about housing in place and how housing can act as a vaccine, home as that vaccine to keep you healthy now and in the future. I'm going to bring you some hot off the press data from our Children's Health Watch around how home is related to population health and then really talk about, I end almost every talk with health equity, and I'm excited to pass on the baton to Carlos Dora to talk about health equity, particularly from the World Health Organization. The evidence on home quality related to health is centuries old. I want to just acknowledge accidents as a really important area that is under-recognized. After motor vehicle accidents, the second leading cause of accidents and deaths is related to home issues, right? Pools and accidents and wiring and other types of things. We talked about asthma already, so I'm going to skip over it. And also, Dave did a wonderful job talking about lead exposure. I also want to acknowledge energy, right? Oftentimes, we think about it as an exposure related to, say, using a gas stove. But in our research, particularly in Children's Health Watch, it's a heat or eat choice, right? Are you going to heat your home or are you going to eat that day? And how that plays out, I think, is a really under-recognized way in which home and home quality are tied together. One of the other areas that I just need to make a nod to is thinking about home quality as it relates to mental health. And this is a brief from the MacArthur series on How Housing Matters. This is research from Boston College, from Rebecca Levine Coley's work, which really showed that poor housing quality was actually the strongest predictor of emotional and behavioral problems in low-income children, and that much of that association through poor housing quality was through parental stress. And so as we think about home and home interactions, don't get me wrong, I'm a pediatrician, I want to talk about kids, but their parents may be another really important area of which we need to start thinking about this. Stability is something that I think we all recognize because we understand homelessness as a really important part of how home is tied to health. But what I say is that homelessness is part of the iceberg you can see. There is a lot of iceberg below the surface. And so there is often maybe 10, 20, 30 families for every homeless family that are hidden homeless, right? That may be housing insecure, things like moving two or more times in a year, being overcrowded or doubled up. In our Children's Health Watch research, we published in the American Journal of Public Health around how housing insecurity was a predictor, particularly with multiple moves, of adverse child health consequences. And a lot of that hidden homelessness is actually operating through unaffordable housing. In our research, we actually show that kids who are multiple moves and kids who are behind on rent often have unbelievable levels of other hardships, right? We're talking about fourfold rates of food insecurity relative to stable families that are not behind on rent, threefold rates of child food insecurity. You're reporting that you're cutting down on the size of kids' meals. Energy insecurity, as I mentioned. And then I think as we tie into the big sector here, the healthcare sector, we're talking about healthcare hardships. Households forgoing care because of cost concerns, children forgoing care because of cost concerns, and making healthcare trade-offs. And so when we think about kind of behind on rent, that becomes a really important operation, because what I'll say is we recognize homelessness and that housing stability, but that other hidden homeless, the people who are moving frequently, and those people that are behind on rent having difficulty with affordability, have very similar health outcomes. I do need to make a nod. When we talk about health, one of the strongest predictors to your long-term health is your education. I was actually asked to make a blog to the Economist Insights section. They asked me for some reason, thinking I would talk about education, and I told them that the secret to education was affordable housing. Because in many urban school districts, there are over 50% of chronic absenteeism, and in some classrooms, over 100% of what's called churn, where you start the school year in one classroom, you finish the school year in another. I actually profiled in Tacoma, Washington. They actually had 179% churn rate in one classroom, right? 20 seats, 54 students went through the classroom. I don't know why it's not talked about more. People talk a lot about education reform and teachers being held accountable, when really, if you don't show up to school and you don't stay long enough in the classroom, I don't know how you actually do good educational reform. And then my good friend, Dr. Renee Boynton-Jarrett, who couldn't be here today and was very upset about not being here, she's part of the Vital Village Network, is a leading, basically, social cohesion kind of intervention based out of Boston Medical Center. And she, Teresa showed up the opportunity maps in Boston. And what Renee did is actually take out of our electronic health record looking at blood pressure rates in three-year-olds. And the bigger the dot is the higher the density of elevations in blood pressure in three-year-olds, right? And what you should look up there is that the bigger the circle, the more likely you are to be in a low opportunity neighborhood, right? And this, we featured this in an article Renee and I wrote for the Academic Pediatric Association, talking about neighborhood level interventions as a way to lift children out of poverty. So this is the biology, right? This is how zip code potentially changes your life course, because if your blood pressure is elevated at age three, your likelihood of heart disease at age 50 is increased. In this audience, I don't have to do public health 101, but I do want to just kind of say, why do I think of home as a vaccine, right? Why do we vaccinate? Well, we vaccinate for personal protection, right? And we want to protect ourselves. But we actually vaccinate many times for herd immunity, right? We're vaccinating because we want to be able to protect not only those that get vaccinated, but those that aren't vaccinated. And you need to make sure enough people in your community are actually able, so that when we see that not many people are vaccinated, I'm not going to do this. All right. If we see not a lot of people are vaccinated, there is not a lot of, but if a lot of people are vaccinated, we actually will see that there's that benefit. And so what we end up seeing now is in certain communities, that's broken down, right? Measles outbreaks in California showed that when you don't have herd immunity, you actually start seeing people getting sick. And so we published in Children's Health Watch over 10 years ago, actually looking at in high-risk groups, what does a housing subsidy mean? And what we showed was that if you were a kid in a food insecure household, you were twofold protected from being underweight if your family received a housing subsidy, compared to a food insecure kid that was eligible for that housing subsidy but not receiving it. So that housing subsidy gave you actually some resilience, some immunity against that risk related to food insecurity. And that's where I think of home can act as a vaccine. When we talk about why we vaccinate in this country, I think the varicella case is actually interesting. Varicella is our fancy word for chickenpox, because I wasn't vaccinated for chickenpox as a kid, but my kids are. And when you look at the economic argument, the cost effectiveness of it, when you look at healthcare costs alone, it does not actually pay off. We are not saving money by vaccinating. We actually, it costs about $2 for every case of chickenpox that we prevent. But when you take into the societal benefits of the vaccination, when you actually look at it, for every dollar you spend on a chickenpox vaccine, you get back $5 when you account work loss. So we don't vaccinate kids just to protect them from having not get chickenpox. We vaccinate it so that their families, their parents still work. And that's where I think that Dr. Frumkin talked about the multiple benefits that we need to be really thoughtful about. Population health is kind of a love-hate term for me, I gotta be honest. I love it in the fact that my sector, the healthcare sector, is finally acknowledging that populations matter, that it's not just the individual patient, we have to think on patterns. I think the harder part of it for me is that it subsumes another term called public health that has been around for centuries and we shouldn't necessarily avoid it. But in our world, we talk about the population health pyramid, right? The high-risk patients, the top 5%, are the ones that cost actually 50% of the healthcare costs. And the rising risk may take up another 20 or 30%. And then you have the lower risk people. Oftentimes, we don't think about the housing risk kind of population health pyramid, homelessness at the top, kind of the housing instability as the middle rising risk, and then the stable housing at the bottom. What I'm going to share with you from Children's Health Watch, which for those who don't know is a nonpartisan network of pediatricians and public health researchers, actually based out of Boston Medical Center and Boston University School of Public Health. And our goal is to improve the health and development of young children through public policies that alleviate economic hardships like hunger, unstable housing, problems keeping the heat or the lights on, or healthcare trade-offs. And our data comes from 5 cities in healthcare where we do a household survey. So it's in Boston, Baltimore, Philadelphia, Little Rock, and Minneapolis. And we focus on a high-risk population, kids 0 to 4. And we interview their households because that is a critical window of time for brain development. And it's largely an invisible population. This is our hot off the press. This is under publication review right now, but I wanted to share it as an example of why housing risk, population health, and healthcare risk, population health merge together. When we think about in our data set, about 9% of families that we interview in this high-risk group of safety net hospitals are homeless. About 6% are multiple moves. They are going at least two times in a year moving where they are. 25% are behind on rent. What's interesting is that most of the time, 86% of the time, you're one of these things, not more than one. So they're very distinct concepts. But what's interesting is that when we look at the range of health outcomes, they're actually fairly similar. In each of these, homelessness, multiple moves, behind on rent, the increased risk of hospitalization in the kids is 20 to 24%. The increased rate of developmental risk, two or more concerns on a PEDS survey, is 26 to 31%. The maternal depression risk is 174 to 268% higher. The child being fair or poor health, 43 to 58% higher. And the mother being in fair or poor health is 91 to 123% higher. So the housing risk is a population health risk. When we think about trying to make populations healthier, we need to think of home as a strategy in addressing population health. So when we think about what that looks like, this stability vital sign is something that we're encouraging people to think about. Where was there a time in the last month when you were not able to pay your mortgage or rent on time? And if you answer yes, you are at high risk. How many places have you lived? If you've lived more than three or more places, you've moved two or more times, you're at risk. At any time where you didn't have a steady place to stay or you stayed in a shelter, that is the definition of homelessness. Yes, you are at high risk. Each of those are important. And I want to thank the Blue Cross Blue Shield Foundation in Massachusetts for helping us develop this housing stability vital sign. Lastly, in my last minute, I just want to talk about a couple of briefs. This is called compounding stress, where we talked about the timing and duration of homelessness in children. What was unique in this is it's not rocket science to say that when you're homeless prenatally, you may have bad health, or if you're homeless postnatally, or that in both periods you would have it. But we saw a persistent risk of kids that were homeless in the prenatal period, even after we controlled for the birth outcomes, of still having increased risk of poor health, of getting hospitalized, of developmental delay. And when we looked at the high-risk group of kids under a year, we saw 250% increased risk of fair or poor health, 100% increased risk of developmental risk if they were homeless at least 6 months out of that first year of life. And when we monetize that, we're seeing hundreds of millions of dollars of potentially avoidable costs related to hospitalizations. The last thing I just want to bring up is the equity gap. When we talk about equality, we often will think treating people equally is our goal. But the problem is if people start at different places, what you end up seeing is that equally treating people does not actually solve the equity gap, right? The tall person gets to the apple of opportunity with that single box. But the other people just get a little bit closer. They don't actually solve it. When you give people the number of boxes they need in order to be able to reach that apple of opportunity is when you address it. And so the uncomfortable truth as we try and move into action is that we have to treat people unequally in order to actually address and give people the opportunities they need to be healthy. I'll argue that first box is always going to be home. That is the foundation. If you don't do home right, nothing else will work. But I believe that we together, through the cross-sector partnerships, can make an enormous difference in being able to move things forward. Thank you very much.
Megan, thanks so much. Patricia asked us to think of housing as a system. You've asked us to think of homes and families as a system. And great insight. Really appreciate that. Carlos, Dora, come on up from all the way from Geneva to share some time and thoughts with us. He's at the intersection, he's the World Health Organization, at the intersection of housing, of transportation, of energy, of urban policy is what he's doing. And you know, Carlos, as I look at the UN Sustainable Development Goals, I see your influence, and thank you for that.
Thank you, Jacques. Very pleased to be with you. I learned a lot today, and I got a lot of inspiration. And that's partly why the reason why I came. From time to time, we need to meet with academics because that's the place that WHO is, as Jack knows well, as David knows well, is where and as you know well, is the place where this international knowledge comes together. How is it that we translate that into, you know, the health inequity worldwide or health inequality worldwide? And I think that's, and at the moment in time, having worked with transport and health, energy and health, housing and health. We're coming for the first time with a technical program on what is urban health for WHO, and we're coining this at the moment. I'm just arriving from Accra, in fact, in Ghana, where we're starting, and we're starting where we think the need is greater, and where we think that what Ron Sims says so well, where we see that the health sector has a very unique role to play. And we want to help the health sector to do that. I think the health sector has intuitively that understanding of that health inequalities are important, that we should be doing something about it. But perhaps we haven't yet equipped the health sector to do what they need to do at the local level. And I come as a doctor, I use WHO materials when I was working with slums in Brazil, where I come from, half a century ago or something close to that. And at that point, I used to work with mental health issues in the community and with things that were very simple, developed by WHO, but we could use at the primary healthcare level. And that stayed with me as an individual as I moved into academia and epidemiology and other things. And I think that's where we would like to go. And your input, and I think my overall pledge here is for you engage in international cooperation. I think we're at the moment what we're doing with Accra, we're moving to Kathmandu, we're engaging with developing country cities exactly in doing action research with local level engagement. And that's where the science and the international knowledge can come together with community needs, opportunity, context. And I think that's where we should be putting this knowledge. And I'm really, really happy that I came, although I'm only here for 24 hours. I think it's more than well worth it. So I'll cover some of how is it that we do. I'll talk a bit about what we do in WHO to give you a sense of where you could contribute and where you could engage. And for me, that was the main purpose of coming having the conversation with you. I'll start with some words about how we use this information, and specifically I'll cover some of the housing and health aspects and energy and health that you've covered here. And then I'll talk about some of the global opportunities that we see coming through and how is it that we, I think, are playing some role at the international level, but that where the health community globally could play a larger role and where we count on you. This is, you've seen this before, is the range of the myriad of risks from housing on health, and it includes social, environmental. And this is just a vision of the social determinants of health, which shows that the physical environment in housing is part of it, is an important part, but it links a lot with other aspects. And certainly, the beauty of that I see in working with the physical environment is the fact that we can operate through the economic analysis, the costs, and through the governance mechanism. We can create rules, regulation, standards, analysis that help us move the agenda or create numbers and information that moves the agenda forward. One of the things that we do that I think many of you have been cooperating is exactly producing WHO guidelines. And I'll speak to that first, because the purpose of that is exactly bringing together international science for the use of policymaking. And Jack has been very involved with the air quality ones, housing and health guidelines. I mean, the National Center for Healthy Housing and HUD, in fact, has done some of the core funding for this, and we're very grateful for that. Very difficult to get anybody to invest on housing and health internationally. This is an example where we used to do the housing, the air quality guidelines, for example, where every chemical which exists in the air or where we have evidence, we produce guidance into what are the safe levels. But with the energy, the household energy guidelines, we moved into the evidence for specific fuels and technology. And that's a very big step, which is the similar one that we're doing for the housing and health guideline. It's not only the specific risk, the contaminant, or the behavior, but is where does it come from. And that's a very substantial change. In fact, and we're saying for the household energy guideline that kerosene should not be used, that coal should not be used, that only very efficient cook stoves should be used. And in the transition from dirty cook stoves, this is mostly for developing countries, into clean cook stoves, that LPG, electricity, ethanol should be used. Now, this, you don't know how much you follow this debate internationally, but there's 45 years of interventions trying to do some mildly improved cook stoves in developing countries, which have not worked at all. And nobody has made a statement, a strong statement about that. And continuing investments from development agencies go in that direction with the belief that, and so we felt that there's some science was needed, and that's done thanks to the international scientists who have been working on that space. So that's helping to change the discourse and the debate around what is it, how is it that we improve household energy risks in developing countries. So I'll come to the housing and guidelines, housing and health guidelines, which are coming out in the near future. I know definitely that Dave Jacobs is involved. I don't know if anybody else here is. But you'll see on the right is a mixture of what we know about housing and health. On the right-hand side is what we have said in other WHO guidelines about water, indoor air quality, outdoor air quality, dampness and mold, radon, neighborhood noise, asbestos, etc. And what other things which are important, where there was enough evidence that, you know, we review systematic reviews this for this first time round. So this is a whole package. And the idea is, and it talks about temperature, it talks about access to public transport. The next package is access to green spaces, which we're still developing, but we believe that it will have the criteria that we need to go into the guidelines. So the whole idea is that we come up with an authoritative statement based on evidence that is issued by a trusted broker, and we have this advantage of being part of the health sector, and the health sector is very trusted. There's numerous, I think, we're very privileged in that way. And there's a transparent and accountable process for putting the evidence together and a firewall against vested interests, which we developed in WHO courtesy to the tobacco industry, who infiltrated research and infiltrated WHO itself, putting people in the, you know, that we didn't know. Having learned that, we created a system which is, we believe, very good to create those kinds of transparency and accountability mechanisms. And what the results are recommendations. And see, the health sector should be recommending that for government, for communities, for individuals. So it's a very strong statement. Of course, we're still limited by the availability of science, by the fact, for example, in housing, we have few of the multi-sectoral interventions or multifactorial interventions which we produce here, which are very, very interesting. We didn't find enough of those to be able to, but I think that's the where we should be going. And this is just a summary of what the WHO guidelines are, is this strong statement that the health sector should be recommending that. And for us, the science community is essential to bring out, and is a way that we translate science into policy in a clear way. As the next steps, as also David was outlining or pointing out, there's an implementation guide, but there's what we think is, how can we create a checklist? Can we create modern legislation or have examples of how, why this? So how is it that we can communicate good practice? Well, can we communicate to communities in developing countries, mostly but worldwide, of how is it that this could be translated into practice and having some capacity building efforts? So that was for housing specifically. The way that we think in terms of knowledge translation has a lot as well to do with economics. Some of you may know this. This is a tool for cost-benefit analysis for non-motorized transport, how much you invest in your city, how much you get in terms of health outcomes or health benefits. This is being called HIT for walking first, then the HIT for cycling, and we're adding, in addition to the physical activity risks, the risks or benefits from air pollution reductions and injury prevention. So it's the kind of knowledge translation tool which can be used and is used very widely, and we feel very strongly about that. Although The other thing about the co-benefits is a recent paper on people who looked at the trade-offs across air pollution and physical activity. And this is especially important for countries which have very high levels of air pollution. But the authors found, this is not WHO work, this is scientists, but they found that there's really, you need to be, the benefits override the risks until quite high levels of ambient air pollution, which is a very reassuring statement. I'm coming into the modeling, and I really like the presentation of modeling because I think this is one of the ways that we can adapt, because the models, and this is one specific model about indoor air in different fuels and technology, and how, and we're developing an adapted version of this model, so sort of that can be used and adapted for each country. The size of your kitchen, the technology that you're using, the kinds of fuels. So this is now being built, and as we're moving with the implementation of the guidelines, we believe that this is one of the ways to make this context, that information context specific. And now I move into opportunities, and where is it that we're focusing our attention and why? And where do we plug our health evidence? So we talked about synthesis of evidence, cost-benefit analysis, knowledge translation, modeling translation, and I gave a few examples. We now go to the political opportunity, and that's essential. And I think we in public health should be making use of that, and we have to harness our skills, either to collaborate with social scientists, but certainly to understand where is it that we have to put, where are the big opportunities. And this is just the growth in urban populations worldwide, and you see that really the world is urbanizing. There's around 60 million new people, new urban residents per year, and slums are part of their package, or poor housing and poor living quarters are part of their package, big way. So that sets up, and there's been, and this is one of the opportunities, there's this global debate on urban, in what how cities should be developed. And it was driven very much by planners. It's a very top-down, thinking that planning is important, which of course it is, and governance and finance. But there was very little talk about people, which was worrying to us, and zero talk about health, which was very worrying to us. So we created an initiative and put together people around the table, wrote a book that was distributed that, and put a lot of political pressure with some governments to change that. And we had, this is the little book which was produced, which clarifies why is it that the greatest asset in a city is health, or the health of its people. And that wasn't in the agenda. And it's this being tweeted, and you know, I don't tweet, but you know, the people who were my journalists and social media people said that this was taken by many governments, and that was we were very pleased with that. And we have an immense amount of communications around this with the people who are operating this space of, I mean, there's still a lot to be done, but we managed to put some elements of health, and I think it's inbuilt in that aspect. The second issue is sustainable development goals, and which is around, it's again part of the global debate, and where there's a number of connections within the SDGs and SDG indicators linking health and the urban environment. And we have the fortune to be the custodian agency. There's lots of work in indicators internationally. But because of the trustworthiness, I think, of WHO, and the fact that we have been moving on indicators and we collaborate with many people, we've been put in charge of many of these indicators. And I think we'll certainly want to use that for the advantage of public health. We think there's a great opportunity. And this, some of the connections are listed there. The third political opportunity worldwide that we're using is air pollution. As you know, there's been recent evidence, I would say in the last 10, 15 years, which have over the vascular impacts of air pollution, which were not known before. And that increased dramatically the burden of disease estimates from air pollution. And we have both a global database on cities, urban air pollution, and some new data and more data on levels of air pollution worldwide and burden of disease. And what we're showing connecting the cities and the air pollution is the increase in outdoor air pollution in developing country cities. While the rich world is improving, the developing world is getting worse, and substantially worse. And we have over 6 years of follow-up of some of the cities, so that gives us an estimate at this. That led, so that's just the trends that I was mentioning. And if you look at what we're doing as the health sector in terms of NCD prevention, this is the global plan. It talks about four risk factors, tobacco, physical inactivity, diet, and excess use of alcohol. But there's no mention of air pollution. And it's been really difficult to get colleagues in the NCD world to take stock from that evidence and to create. So we still have a lot of work to do, and I think that's one of the things that we should be cooperating in. How is it that the NCD prevention, and you've been doing lots of research on that, can build on other things which are not those four risk factors? Sometimes this decision to focus can be helpful, but sometimes they can create a level of a complacency that, you know, because there was this decision, a UN Assembly resolution in 2011, then we should be repeating that mantra forever. And I think that's certainly one of the challenges that I think this community could help engage with, and that's something that we see. The air pollution story got picked up by the Ministers of Health, which made a WHO resolution, which talks completely about the sources of air pollution and how the health sector can work with, or should work with, other sectors, and how cities and homes are a place to focus first. So for us, it's a very useful to have that kind of mandate, because it's very strong, and it comes, in that case, it comes with a very concrete and operational, as a roadmap for how to get there, which talks about the kinds of things that we're talking here. The fourth, I think, opportunity is climate change. And as you know, the conversation of health being part of climate change is being part of the introductory discussions, but whenever it comes to funding or to decisions on climate change, mitigation especially, the health sector is completely out. And there's now the new climate fund that for cities, so we're making that connection between what sector policies on the left, how much of them, and the issue of the multiple benefits, how many of those produce health benefits, not only through climate change mitigation. I mean, the health impacts of climate change are relatively small in the long term and very diffuse. They are worldwide. Whilst if you pick the health benefits from interventions to mitigate climate change on the local people who are taking those policies in terms of injury prevention, air pollution reduction, noise, diet, those health benefits are enormous. And they're not yet in the conversation of climate change with the countries where they're making the decisions about climate change mitigation, or in the UNFCCC. Well, the international panel, I'm talking the convention discussions. The convention debates with the ministers of environment and foreign affairs, they don't talk about this. So we think that there's a space there that we should be pushing. Certainly the analysis, scientific analysis have been talking about that, but there's not yet in the political debate. So I think there's another place. In this year in Marrakesh, just 3 weeks ago, we had a first coalition of ministers of health and environment working on this issue, and they decided to focus on air pollution reductions and health benefits as the first step in sort of moving health and environment in the climate change agenda. So it's really changing and the fact that the Minister of Health went to the climate change, to the UNFCCC meeting is the first one. We haven't had that before. So those are the opportunities. And the last point that I'll mention is, how do we bring this to reality in parts of the world where, there's more difficulty? And we're starting in Africa and with what we are calling the Urban Health Initiative. As I said, I'm just coming from Accra directly, where we've been working with local authorities, the local health sector, researchers, and a number of other people in bringing, how is it that the health sector can help bring that change? And the health knowledge and the health science, the health evidence, working with producing local evidence. And that's a bit the overall model. We bring the knowledge that we've been discussing here, that how we presented so well, We bring the tools like the economic tools or the models that also have been discussed here, how we can strengthen capacity at the local level, but with the idea that that knowledge, which is how many people are exposed locally, what are the policy options, local policy options, how many people will benefit from, what are the savings for the health system, for out-of-pocket expenditure of the local people. So creating that understanding using analysis of local evidence, and that evidence is being produced by the local health people with the municipality, with the sectors which are creating those risks, transportation, energy, waste management, very big in Africa still. So that to create a local demand for cleaner and better policies, and to create a transformation, to really influence the local policymaking. So that's a bit of as a bit of awareness, creating this understanding of the local data and having local production of knowledge, engaging different stakeholders. The health sector is leading because it's about how health can create a transformation. But it's done in connection with, so there's a knowledge part, where are the good policies? How much work have you done here which is relevant to those contexts? To use health impact assessment, big way, in creating some health scenarios about what are the benefits of the local policies to the local population. Doing costs of inaction, and this have not been done. So I think that's interesting. We're using cost analysis and health economics and health databases to use this analysis. But people have not been, and you may have more experience here, looking at the costs of not taking action in transportation, in household energy, in waste management, to the health of the local population. And that could, I think, help create a narrative that engages people on that. There's a very big part to do with mapping out the policies which are in the policy options at the local level, which again, we tend to talk about the health impacts, the inequity, but we don't go very firmly into what are the policy options that it is at the local level. In creating for the locals a health scenario, I don't have still an African health scenario, this has been produced for London, I'm sorry, but the idea is that, and I borrowed the idea from a meeting that we had in Colombia some time ago, when Galea was there, where we put Department of Planning and Department of Public Health together. And they have this experience of visioning the city and the future of the cities with artists and with public health people and with others. And that's what we're trying to pilot. And we're working with local artists and local, there's a fort or almost a third of the project is on communication, is investment in the ability of talk about those things at the local level and the efforts there. So I thank you for the opportunity. I think the question is how do we bring this to the global health equity, to create global health equity, and I think your contribution is essential for that. Thank you.
Thank you for refocusing us on a global issue, because that's the commonality of this. Could I have the panel members? I've asked John Levy. Let's just stand up here. We don't have to sit down. We only have a few minutes. John has allowed us to have a few questions addressed. So you can sit. That's fine. But I've got to pick up on the point you were leaving off on, and I'm going to ask it this way. There's elements and aspects of it in all your talks, but how do you create a social movement around this? I think of how does Cesar Chavez make women shopping in Lexington, Mass. Care about grapes that they picked? How does this happen? You know, and where are we in this consciousness that comes down to carbon in many cases, the underlying thread here in the use of carbon. But it's more than that. It's the benefits that we leave on the table by not attending to these things. So any of you, how do you do this? And then we'll open it up.
Well, I'll just briefly say, I think in my, I,
I joked at dinner last night that I actually am less about evidence now and more about framing and communication, which is, as someone who trained as a researcher, a proud graduate of BU School of Public Health as a Master's of Public Health, I say that with a little bit of trepidation, and yet I think that communication matters a lot, and I think that we need to frame the message not in an other way, but as a collective, and right, being good. Able to really make it the argument that everyone benefits from this. This is about stable homes for healthy families in communities, and what does that look like? I also think that I am of the mindset that a positive frame is actually an important part too, and that as we think about it, we can make a communication which is, and this is hard as researchers to say this, is evidence is clear, urgency is now, this is solvable. And I think that three pivot, because I think that's as nice. Researchers, we sometimes muddy the waters for ourselves and we're like, well, we're not really sure and we don't have enough evidence and it'd be nice if, you know, it's not really generalizable. And no, like, we understand enough. Perfect is the enemy of good. And we need to be able to be very decisive in making recommendations and making sure that it feels solvable instead of overwhelming.
Well said. Publications are not enough. It is the is into the practice. But yeah. Go ahead, Carl.
I think I certainly agree with that. But I think the other thing is listening and being able to see where people are, who are your audiences, which is the mantra of communicators, right? But that's enormous value. And I think that when I show the opportunities, because these are the kinds of things that people are worried about. And you have to be able to work with that and include the framing and adapt the framing and use the evidence according to their concerns. And I think that's why this business of the African cities, I think we'll go and see what's really bothering people. And we start from that, and then you build where's the evidence for that. From the, and we do have the evidence, I agree completely. But listening is an ability which I think we have to have as well.
I would just say the last point here is that, you know, we're not all on our own here, right? That these are webs, it's a web, and so we need to work together. These are, as Ron Sim says best, you know, we have to act together, and the social fabric has frayed, let's face it. Mm-hmm. So the question is, you know, how do you restore that? Because people at the end of the day said, I said this last night too, no matter how you voted, people think things are broken. And we in public health would be the first to admit that, yeah, there's a lot of things that don't work right, so we should fix them. Let's use that as an opportunity to build that movement so that people want people, so that we can fix things that people perceive as broken. That's my frame anyway.
So someone has the mic, right? Pass it around. Yeah, please.
The question to follow up, particularly to Megan. I listened to all the presentations. They're all compelling and fascinating, yet if I hear your presentation correctly, the key to all this is housing instability. Without housing, you have nothing. And yet these are people who fall below the safety net, people who are below Section 8 or don't qualify or are waiting decades, if not longer, for Section 8 vouchers. And even those housing units aren't perfect. How do we get that discussion? What do we do about housing? Because we can look at windows, we can look at IPM, and we're chipping away at the edges. How do we get to the core issue? And now, for example, Matthew Desmond wrote Evicted, came out earlier this year. It started a discussion nationwide, but now it's disappeared. How do we maintain that? How do we continue it? How do we sustain that discussion?
Yeah, I think it's a great question. So Jack mentioned I sit on the board of a housing organization called Enterprise Community Partners, first physician to be on the board. And the chairman of the board is a guy named Ron Terwilliger, who started his own foundation around Housing America's Families. And we actually held a forum in New Hampshire, right, about a month before the New Hampshire primary, and invited a bunch of presidential candidates specifically to get it talked about on the campaign trail. It was one of the most frustrating forums because most people were asking about Syria. And Syria is important, don't get me wrong, but we were having a housing forum to talk about housing, and we still couldn't get questions about housing. So I think you are totally right, and it is part of why I think our communication framing has failed, because we have not been able, we talk about poverty and inequality, when I would argue that home builds more poverty and inequality than anything else in this country. Where you're born to is an important predictor, and that is where, like, squarely with home. And so I do think that it is something where
it's in, Matt and I were having coffee on Monday about how do we keep the conversation going. I think we do need to be very thoughtful about how we raise it up. I do tend to think that stability, stable homes is something that everyone can identify with. And it is really important that it feels like something that everyone can identify with. And then the key is that what is honestly government's role in creating stable homes for healthy families? And I think there are very proven tools out there, like the low-income housing tax credit, like actually universal vouchers or Section 8 vouchers, like there's some new ideas around renters tax credits that I think have some legs, and I am going to be a little bit of the glasses half full person here. I think we have to push forward with those campaigns that we need stable homes, that that's been the missing piece, and that we need to be able to use the opportunity that people haven't talked about it as an opportunity to then say, this is the missing piece, this is the key. People have not figured it out, and now we've got this great solution that's evidence-based, and we need to move forward with it.
Any other question? Thanks, that was a great response. Any other questions? Yeah, please.
Thank you. Throughout the day, we've heard a lot about the problem, the health outcomes. You've many mechanisms, pathways, logic models have been suggested, and we've heard examples of potential opportunities to intervene. Thinking about all that might be possible, you know, I also want to think about unanticipated adverse consequences for any interventions or policies that might be put forth. And I was just curious as to what extent health impact assessment is being included in the conversation as a critical part of the next step.
I can mention something at an international level following what you said, health impact assessment. Just published, in fact, in Nature. Fires in Sumatra have impact on mortality in Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore. There's a health impact of, and not housing, but of an illegal operation for palm oil primarily. This is setting off an international dilemma because deaths are occurring elsewhere. And I think you can go back to right down to urban settings. And you can, why don't you talk, David, about Michigan? I think that's appropriate. That's tying health impacts into the solutions.
Well, in some ways it's infuriating that it takes something like Flint to focus the mind on what I think people would have thought as part of our infrastructure. And yet it turns out that lead pipes, if they're on your private property, they're yours. They're not part of the publicly owned infrastructure. So I think people kind of got it, you know, that we should do something. And so in that vein, for the first time, HHS approved a Medicaid waiver for the state of Michigan to do lead pipe and lead paint abatement to the tune of $160 million. The whole appropriation for HUD for lead paint abatement is $110. So there's an opportunity there, whether it's fires in Somalia or a disaster like Flint that should, I think everybody gets that shouldn't have happened. And I think that's a common point. Paint historically has been perceived as a poor person's disease. And even with housing stability, I think most people would say, well, that's not really my problem, that's the problem of the poor. But when it comes to something like water or a mortgage crisis, everybody is involved. It's part of our shared commons. And so we need to find ways to build on that so that there's a perception that we all have a stake in this together. I think that is by far, in terms of the lead world, that Medicaid waiver is the biggest news in a long time. I mean, for decades, we fought to get them to fund home inspections or even pay blood lead tests, and now they're going to pay for abatement. So, you know, that's an opportunity where the unnecessary wall between health and housing finance has sort of broken down because everybody understood that's the right thing to do.
That's a health impact assessment. Had effect.
Close that up, I think the waiver argued basically that it was a medical intervention, that is, making a lead-safe home was a medically necessary intervention, and therefore that's why Medicaid should pay for it, at least in the state of Michigan. Now it's a waiver, so it's not nationwide, but I think there's an opportunity. Let's think about that across the nation.
What we're thinking internationally is the package that we say, what is it that an urban health team, what they should be able to do to be able to advise, you know, in general? I mean, what's the model? What is HIA, is health economics, is modeling scenarios and advice from the clinicians and primary healthcare, you know, front staff in terms of what kind of that. So that's what we have in mind in terms of the package, working and understanding the policies. But to do an HIA, you have to understand what the policy options are. And in addition to the HIA is normally upfront, you're looking at the future, but the tracking of health impacts following a frame which is talks about the source, et cetera, is something which we think is very important.
Just going to say that's a gap, right? I think health impact assessments are just health assessments. And obviously I live in this modeling world, but the reason that we do modeling is because we don't have all the information right across all the tracks. So we didn't talk about, say, housing impact on cardiovascular health. And you can make those links. So I think that health impact assessments and other health analyses are the way to actually make people care, right? Now you're connecting. It's not just about what kind of housing do you have? Is it just for poor people, et cetera? But this is going to impact your risk of having a heart attack or having asthma, et cetera. And I think that's a way to sort of elevate it. And we're sort of missing, there's a big gap there.
So unfortunately, we'll have to march on. We do have some speakers in the final panel of Flights to Catch, so I want to be sort of aware of their time constraints.